Welcome to this talk on the physiological changes in pregnancy. Pregnancy is associated with a number of profound physiological and anatomical changes that both assist in fetal survival as well as prepare the mother for delivery. It's important to know what the parameters of these normal changes are in order to diagnose and manage other medical problems that may occur in pregnancy. By the end of this lecture, you will be able to describe the physiological changes in pregnancy in terms of the cardiovascular, respiratory, hematological, and gastrointestinal systems. You'll also understand the impact of these changes on the management of the pregnant patient. Pregnancy induces profound changes in the woman's anatomy and physiology. The female body begins to adapt to the growing demands of the fetus even before pregnancy may be clinically detected. These complex series of physiological and anatomical changes are primarily hormonally mediated and affect every system of the body. The primary goals are to optimize maternal conditions for fetal growth, prepare for delivery, and to develop the mother's breasts for the production of milk. First, let's take a look at the cardiovascular changes in pregnancy. The cardiac output increases as a function of two changes in how the heart works. One, there's an increase in stroke volume, or the blood volume pumped out of the heart per beat. This is predominantly as a result of increased blood volume. Two, there's an increase in the resting heart rate. The heart rate is about 15 beats per minute higher than in non-pregnant women. As you remember, the cardiac output is the product of the stroke volume and the heart rate. Thus, this results in a steady rise in cardiac output, which rises about 50% above the pre-pregnancy cardiac output. The blood pressure, however, as you can see from the graph, takes a slight dip at the beginning and then slowly rises. Thus, it's relatively stable. Thus, with a stable BP and an increase in cardiac output, there must be a decrease in systemic vascular resistance. Another change you may see during the later stages of pregnancy is aerocable compression, or compression of both the inferior vena cava and the lower aorta when the patient is supine. This leads to a reduction in venous return and thus a fall in cardiac preload. The fall in cardiac preload may lead to reduced cardiac output, which may threaten perfusion. Furthermore, compression of the aorta may lead to reduced perfusion to the uterus and placenta, as well as the kidneys. It's been shown that during the last trimester, maternal kidney function is lower in the supine position than when sitting or standing. Fetal transplacental gas exchange may also be affected due to decreased perfusion to the placenta. As a result, one should advise women not to lie supine during the later stages of pregnancy. The respiratory tract also undergoes changes in response to the maternal adaptation to pregnancy. Starting at the upper airways, hormone-induced changes to the mucosal vasculature of the upper airways leads to capillary engorgement, congestion, and edema. This may lead to nasal stuffiness and, more importantly, difficulties with intubation in the case that emergent cesarean sections become necessary. Minute ventilation rises by 50% at term, as you can see in the graph on the right. Progesterone, a known stimulant of the respiratory drive, gradually rises throughout pregnancy. It is thought to increase the sensitivity to carbon dioxide, such that increased CO2 elicits an exaggerated respiratory effort. Progesterone is also known to reduce airway resistance by bronchial and tracheal smooth muscle relaxation. The functional residual capacity, or FRC, or the apneic reserve of oxygen, decreases by 20%, while the inspiratory capacity remains the same. This is partly due to the mechanical effect of the gravid uterus causing elevation of the diaphragm, as well as the hormonal changes associated with pregnancy. As a result, the pregnant patient has a decreased ability to tolerate periods of apnea. Pregnant women also have a marked increase in their oxygen consumption by up to 40 to 50% over non-pregnancy levels. This decreases the partial pressure of carbon dioxide and gives rise to the chronic respiratory alkalosis of pregnancy. Now let's review some of the hematological changes in pregnancy. As you can see from the graph, blood volume increases by 50 to 100%. At the same time, red blood cell counts only increase by 25 to 40%. This is why the hematocrit dips down in this graph, because we have what's called physiological anemia of pregnancy, or dilutional anemia. Elevated erythropoietin levels increase total red blood cell mass, but hemoglobin concentrations never reach pre-pregnancy levels because you're also having an increase in the overall plasma volume. At the same time, the increased red blood cell production also creates a fall in serum iron, while increasing the transferrin and total iron binding capacity. As you can also see from the graph, there's also a rise in the total white blood cells during pregnancy. Levels of some clotting factors, including 7, 8, 9, and 10, as well as fibrinogen, increase during pregnancy, while fibrinolytic activity decreases. This increases the risk of thromboembolic disease. The whole point of this increased coagulability, though, is to protect from hemorrhage at delivery, but it also puts the mother at risk for getting DVTs during pregnancy. Finally, let's complete our overview of the physiological changes in pregnancy by discussing briefly the musculoskeletal, endocrine, and renal changes in pregnancy. In terms of the musculoskeletal system, there are elevated levels of relaxin, which helps prepare for delivery by softening the cervix, inhibiting uterine contractions, and relaxing the pubic symphysis. This increased ligamentous laxity, however, leads to an increased risk for back injury and pubic symphysis dysfunction. In terms of the endocrine changes, there are increased levels of prolactin to prepare for breastfeeding, linearly increasing levels of corticotropin-releasing hormone, which is thought to be a possible stimulant for labor, and increased insulin production in order to maintain blood sugar levels. Pregnancy is also associated with increased insulin resistance due to the secretion of human placental lactogen, thus the risk for gestational diabetes mellitus. Renal changes include increased urinary stasis. This is due to smooth muscle relaxation of the renal pelvis, ureters, and bladder, with an increase in bladder capacity and residual urine volume. This urinary stasis leads to an increased risk for UTIs. There's also increased activation of the renin-angiotensin system, which leads to increased sodium retention and edema.